Hello and welcome to Talk Back, the show where we ask tough, compelling questions from tough, compelling people. Kashmir is his destiny. It runs in his blood. He is the third generation leader of the pro-autonomy yet pro-India national conference. In an election year, he's looking to win hearts and minds. Some call him the new boss, same as the old boss. We are about to find out if there is any truth in that. Omar Abdullah, welcome to Talk Back.
Thank you.
I want to read you a quote here from 1952, August, Jawaharlal Nehru, the Prime Minister of India, speaking on the floor of the House. It's a little long, so bear with me. We want no people in the territory of India against their ill will and with the help of the armed forces. If the people of Jammu and Kashmir wish to part with us, they can go their way and we shall go ours. We want no forced marriages and no forced unions. This great Republic of India is a free, voluntary, friendly and affectionate union of the states of India. We openly said to them, to the people of Jammu and Kashmir and to the world, that we will give them a chance to decide and we will stand by that decision in this matter. Therefore, we must honor that pledge. Why has no government of India honored this pledge? What went wrong?
I don't think it's a question of just governments of India. I think successive governments in Pakistan also played a part in ensuring that we reached the point today where the United Nations Secretary General Kofi Annan, on a visit to the subcontinent, declared these Security Council resolutions as irrelevant and unenforceable. There are any number of reasons. The fact that India and Pakistan couldn't agree upon who would carry out the plebiscite, the fact that we couldn't agree upon where, which areas would be entitled to the plebiscite, the fact that we couldn't agree upon the force levels that would be maintained. The United Nations called for a complete withdrawal of Pakistani forces from the territories of Jammu and Kashmir and a bare minimum number of Indian forces, which was never carried out. And this thing was dragged on and on and on until we've reached the point where we have today, where it's inconceivable to imagine that what Jawaharlal Nehru promised in 1952 would be made available to the people of Jammu and Kashmir today.
But there is demilitarization thing going on, this tone which the Pakistani president, for example, has pitched. How's that working out as far as his 4 points are concerned?
Well, his 4 points are definitely something that has gathered a lot of attention, both within the state of Jammu and Kashmir as well as within the rest of India. Obviously, the government of India has been forced to take into account what President Musharraf has said. Demilitarization was one suggestion that he made. Obviously, he wasn't able to at least publicly explain what he meant by demilitarization, and therefore different people have interpreted it to suit their own purposes. Unilateral demilitarization by India is not possible. It's like asking Pakistan to unilaterally demilitarize the northern areas. You're not going to do it. And you can't expect India to unilaterally demilitarize an area that shares a border both with Pakistan and with China, two countries that India has fought, unfortunately, wars with in its past. But there is a claim to be made for force reduction in troop levels, particularly those troops that were brought into Jammu and Kashmir after militancy started in 1989, because both the government of India and the government of J&K show us these amazing graphs about reduction in violence levels, but they don't show us graphs about reduction in troop levels. And therefore, if violence levels are coming down, logically one should dictate that the peace dividend would allow for a time frame within which troop levels can also be brought down. And that, I think, is a much more reasonable interpretation of demilitarization.
But there is the school of thought, and it's especially true to say that it exists in Pakistan, that India is the larger partner in the so-called peace process, should demilitarize, at least a phased demilitarization campaign.
Sure, a phased campaign can be thought of, but it, as I said, it won't be unilateral. Why would you expect India to compromise its security interests just because area-wise and population-wise it's a larger country than Pakistan?
Well, 750,000 troops in the valley.
Well, that figure again is debatable. It is not just troops.
That's the one which goes around, though.
You are sure, it does. It is not just troops. And that's why I'm saying that more realistic is to talk about pre-1989 levels, because Jammu and Kashmir has always had a certain amount of troop presence. It has been largely invisible, so to speak. It hasn't affected the day-to-day lives of people up until 1989, when militancy started and obviously troop levels and their locations in civilian areas started. So sure, the case that we make in my party is that in areas where militancy levels have gone down drastically, in those areas you should begin looking at returning to the pre-1989 positions and levels of troops, and let the JNK police, sufficiently trained and armed, be tasked with looking after law and order and security environments.
Who do you credit for the lessening of militancy?
First and foremost, the events of 9/11. Secondly, the attack on the Indian Parliament, because these two events, 9/11 focused attention on the region, particularly Pakistan and Afghanistan. The attack on our parliament sparked a huge eye-to-eyeball confrontation between our two countries, which scared the rest of the world witless that these were two nuclear powers that were staring at each other down the barrel of a gun. And a lot of pressure was brought to bear on both countries to step back from that standpoint and begin a process of engagement leading to lessening tensions. Obviously, the leadership of the day, particularly the then Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee and your President, General Musharraf, were instrumental in ensuring that we could move back from a situation where everybody was seeing war clouds and reach a point where we could shake hands and actually sit down and talk.
Then why is there stagnancy now?
Partly due to the situation in your country and partly due to the situation in ours. I don't think anybody had expected General Pervez Musharraf's power to erode as rapidly as it has done. I hadn't, certainly hadn't factored this into my considerations when I was talking about working out a negotiated settlement with Pakistan. To the extent that political pressures have always been brought to bear on Indian political leadership, sure, that's been a factor as well. Let's not forget that our Prime Minister and his government has been almost, in terms of foreign policy, almost singularly focused on the Indo-US civilian nuclear agreement, which itself has run into political trouble. And therefore, both these factors have played a role in slowing down the political, the peace process.
Some in Pakistan say that President Musharraf's 4 points, that pitch he made, are a huge compromise from Pakistan. They're a huge offer of goodwill, a huge gesture, but that hasn't been reciprocated from India.
Well, I would caution only this much, that India now, let me put it this way, that at that time, Pakistan was not really what you would call a democracy. General Pervez Musharraf was the single most important person in Pakistan, the single most powerful person in Pakistan.
There was a parliament in place.
But let's be honest, to what extent was the president accountable to that parliament? General Pervez Musharraf was in charge of the government, he was in charge of the army, he was in charge of all the security paraphernalia that was needed to move policy through
but
Pakistan.
But India was dealing with him.
India, no, I'm not saying we shouldn't have dealt with him. What I'm saying is that Dr. Manmohan Singh didn't have that advantage. He heads a coalition of 24, 25 parties, including outside support from the left. He has a parliament that is incredibly vocal and an opposition that is sometimes very strident, even about policies that they themselves initiated. And therefore, to have expected a public response from Prime Minister Manmohan Singh to General Pervez Musharraf's public proposals was perhaps to have expected too much. But let's not forget, Dr. Manmohan Singh was very forthcoming in two speeches he made in Amritsar. The second one was when he flagged off the Amritsar Nankana Sahab bus, when he talked exactly along the lines of General Pervez Musharraf's four-point formula in terms of joint power-sharing arrangements, in terms of people-to-people contact, in terms of soft borders, in terms of lines cannot be redrawn, but they can be made irrelevant. And there was, to my understanding, a fair amount of progress that was made behind the scenes in our dialogue with your country. But yes, there is certainly the complaint can be made from your side that we didn't publicly respond perhaps as openly as we should have done to General Musharraf's suggestions. I've made this complaint myself.
And that was because of political constraints, you think?
What other constraints would there be?
Is there, I guess you could call it the mood, is the mood in India, the people of India, are they in the mood for peace with Pakistan?
Yes.
And is the government selling that pitch to the people?
No. Peace with Pakistan is today at least not an issue that is getting much traction in terms of a discourse amongst the people or as a selling point of this government.
What do you think that is?
Well, I think this government has its plate full with so many problems, they don't know where to start. You have inflation at 7%. You have a stock market that's shown a tremendous fall. You have a slowing down of growth. You have an Indo-US civilian nuclear agreement, which may not be a talking point, but it's something that the government has attached a lot of political capital to. You have a continued crisis in agriculture. And whether we like it or not, Kashmir is relatively peaceful, and therefore it's almost a case of out of sight is out of mind. And since Kashmir is anyway peaceful, it's not something they need to talk about.
So there's bigger fish to fry.
There are, yeah, in a country of this size.
But Kashmir is pretty important, Mr. Abdullah.
I'm not saying that it's not important to the government. It's just not a selling point for the government at this point. It might be when the election come up, but it's not a selling point right now. And I guess they're right. They don't really have much to sell in terms of any concrete achievements.
I can't just say that India is plain and simple, intransigent, especially after the 4 points.
No, as I said, my understanding, even from your leadership of that time, who I had the chance of meeting when I was recently in Islamabad, there was a lot of progress that had been made. The only difference was that India was not as vocal.
But don't you think that's important in diplomacy?
Being vocal? I think more often than not, it's useful to keep quiet and let things move along.
It's important for the people, though, because there is this impasse in Pakistan.
Well, you can't sell the people a solution that you haven't yet arrived at.
But then there's been all this talk of CBMs, for example. Now, you've criticized some of the CBMs. You've said that the buses are running empty, that as far as the process is concerned, it's too arbitrary, it's too long. There's intelligence agencies involved, there's visa officials involved. What is the point of these bureaucrats and these politicians making these CBMs if they're just going to be put on paper and not in the process?
My point exactly. I've made this point both in India and in Pakistan, that the CBMs, rather than us looking at fresh CBMs that we can offer the people of Jammu and Kashmir, what we need to do is make sure the CBMs that we've already put on the table actually work.
See, that's why there's the school of thought in Pakistan which says that the CBMs are really all talk.
No, they're not all talk. Talk is important, but after talk, you need to implement. And I think the problem with the CBMs is that they need to come up for review now.
But do you think who wants to make peace more right now, politically? Pakistan, the Pakistani government, or India, as in the Indian
government?
Well,
I think you now have a new government in Pakistan. And even though the noises from that new government have been encouraging, I think we need to give your government a bit of time to settle down and find their feet. The same way this government has much bigger fish to fry, as you said, your government has no lesser big fish to fry. You've got a constitution that needs to be restored, a judiciary that some would say needs to be set right, and a government that needs to find its feet after a number of years out in the wilderness.
All right, we have to take a short break here. We're with Umar Abdullah. You're watching Talk Back. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Talk Back. We are with Umar Abdullah. Mr. Abdullah, is autonomy a pipe dream?
No, not at all. I think it fits in both with the constitutionally mandated position that Jammu and Kashmir has within the Indian constitution, and also fits into what President Pervez Musharraf's four-point proposal was in terms of self-rule or self-governance. You call your side of Jammu and Kashmir Azad Kashmir. Obviously, that means that it has a greater degree of freedom than perhaps your other parts of Pakistan within the Pakistani Union. And therefore, there's no reason why autonomy to both sides should remain a pipe dream.
But then there's, for example, Article 370. Your party has allied itself with another party, the BJP, in the past.
No, we haven't allied ourselves with the BJP. We were part of an alliance called the National Democratic Alliance. Yes, one of the constituents of that alliance was the BJP. But at no point in time was the agenda of the National Democratic Alliance either the rebuilding of the Ram Temple, nor was it scrapping of Article 370, and nor was it the Common Civil Code. We would never have been able to align with any party that had its agenda for governance that included those three issues. And let's not forget, even though we were a part of the NDA, we still fought elections against the BJP in Jammu and Kashmir. It was never an electoral alliance. It was an alliance of governments and parties, but it was never reduced to the level of fighting elections on each other's platforms.
Would you work with the BJP in the future?
I think it's highly unlikely, given the experience that we had working with them. We were alliance partners, we were part of the NDA, and yet they starved the state for funds like perhaps it had never been starved before. And the moment our government was replaced by another, suddenly the coffers opened up and money flowed into J&K. So our past experience hasn't been the best one.
See, there's been at least a couple of moments. I remember, like, for example, the Gujarat killings. Weren't they a reason enough to head out of the NDA, to break away from the BJP?
This was a question that I was asked in Jammu in a press conference yesterday as well. And the answer I gave you is gave them is the one I'm going to give you today. I did resign from the government. I even voted in parliament against the government of which I was a part. But I didn't press my resignation. And the reason, perhaps mistakenly so now with hindsight, I should have. The reason I didn't press the resignation was I didn't believe that Atal Bihari Vajpayee was responsible for what happened in Gujarat. Narendra Modi was. And by resigning from Atal Bihari Vajpayee's government, I would perhaps have been painting the finger of blame on him. I think what Mr. Atal Bihari Vajpayee was guilty of doing was not stopping Mr. Narendra Modi. But I made the mistaken judgment call that I didn't want to hold him responsible for what was happening in Gujarat. It was primarily Narendra Modi's responsibility. Maybe with hindsight, that judgment call wasn't the right one to make.
But some say that you just hung on primarily because of the power.
No, if I had to hang on, I would have stayed on. I quit government in October of that year anyway.
All right. Step one, step two. Is autonomy step one and is independence step two?
No. Independence is not an option for Jammu and Kashmir. It is not feasible. Jammu and Kashmir, for various reasons, not the least of which is geographic, is not a land that we can conceivably imagine as an independent country, especially when it's squeezed between neighbors like Afghanistan, Pakistan, China, and India.
What about self-determination then?
I don't see circumstances under which self-determination becomes a viable option. The map of Jammu and Kashmir has been so distorted, particularly on the Pakistani side, that it's difficult to imagine a situation where self-determination becomes a viable option. At least
on the Pakistani side?
I'm coming to that. Whatever complaints I might have against the government of India for whatever they've done, they haven't tinkered around with the territory of Jammu and Kashmir after the ceasefire line or the line of control was drawn. The Jammu and Kashmir that existed then is the Jammu and Kashmir that exists now. Even the demography, because of Article 370 and the state subject laws that we have, even the demography has not been tinkered with. You haven't had a flood of non-state subjects into the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Your map of Jammu and Kashmir is very different from the map that it was in 1947. What you call Azad Kashmir is only a fraction of the Jammu and Kashmir that you actually have control over. Your northern areas were traditionally Jammu and Kashmir. Now they're federally administrated areas. Aksai Chin is a part of Jammu and Kashmir, which you chose to gift to China for reasons that are best known to you. And therefore, your map of Jammu and Kashmir is very different from what it was in 1947. Your demography is very different from what it was in 1947. And therefore, to expect in such changed circumstances that you will give the right to self-determination along the patterns of what was proposed in 1947 is not feasible.
There's also this school of thought, especially some would say, which is rampant in the region, is that, and a lot of people on both sides perhaps agree with this, perhaps you might not, that as far as cultural affinities are concerned, as far as geographical affinities are concerned, sentiments are concerned, Kashmir, and perhaps Kashmir more than Jammu, is closer to Pakistan, what exists of the Pakistan-Kashmir today. What do you think?
I wouldn't be able to comment on that. I haven't seen a lot of
cultural links.
Sure, there are links, and that's why we are saying that lines should be made irrelevant. Why would you need to change sovereignty to join people? You haven't needed to change sovereignty between Belgium and France and the UK and Spain, but you've made those lines irrelevant. Why would you hold us hostage to that line on the ground and say, only if this line changes will we allow you to meet freely? Why can't the line stay where it is, and yet you make it so irrelevant that we can come together as people, we can rebuild those transport links, we can rebuild those social links, we can rebuild those family links, and yet you don't tinker around with the nationality that we have. We'll live the way we are, and we'll work together.
So self-independence no more.
I don't see how it's possible. I would love for somebody to come forward and suggest to me how independence for Jammu and Kashmir is a viable option. I have numerous arguments with those people who talk about the right to self-determination and then stop from giving the third option of independence. They limit it to only choosing between India and Pakistan. That's not self-determination. I mean, you talk about implementing the United Nations Security Council resolutions, but they don't give you the third option. They limit it only to two, choosing between India and choosing between Pakistan. And as I said, the world has changed from 1947. Jammu and Kashmir has changed from 1947. It's not to suggest that there isn't support for this in parts of Jammu and Kashmir. But my job is not to sell people a dream. My job is to sell people what is realistically possible and what is feasible.
Okay. Why was the plebiscite? Let's talk about that. Let's go a little back in history. 1975, the Indira-Sheikh Accord, which your grandfather, Sheikh Abdullah, signed. He came to power as the chief minister of the state and gave up on the plebiscite, on the demand of the plebiscite, disbanded the plebiscite front. Some say that was the beginning of the end as far as self-determination is concerned.
No, it was the realization on the part of my grandfather that all this was going to do was to destroy Kashmiris further, and that it was not going to happen. Let's not forget that these discussions and dialogues started in the face of Pakistan being broken into two countries. You had East Pakistan and West Pakistan that split into Pakistan and Bangladesh. You had Pakistan that faced a horrible defeat at the hand of Indian forces after the 71-72 war. You had the similar agreement. And there was a lot, I mean, it's very easy for us to sit at this point in time and try and understand what were the circumstances under which these discussions and these dialogues took place. But you need to look at the overall situation and then realize that my grandfather took a view that it is in the best interest of the people of Jammu and Kashmir to remain a part of India and to have their own identity. But within the constitutional union that exists.
But some people say, his detractors say, sir, that he was purchased. It was a U-turn for power. It was a compromise.
Power is not given by an individual. Power is given by the people. And even if for a moment you would like to believe that it was a U-turn, he was elected after this agreement by an overwhelming majority of people of Kashmir in 77. And therefore, even if it was a U-turn, it was a U-turn that was endorsed by the majority of Kashmir. You don't get to buy people. People endorsed it. I mean, if you wanted a greater endorsement of what he did, look at the video footage of his funeral in 1982. That will give you an endorsement of how much people believed in what he had done.
Well, the plebiscite, giving up the plebiscite is a bit of
why
a
not? No, of course not.
What was the National Conference thinking at that point by giving up the demand for the plebiscite?
The National Conference,
which it espoused at that point,
sure,
right till then.
The National Conference put the interests of the people of Jammu and Kashmir in front of everybody else and decided that this is in the best interests of the people of the state because they don't need the uncertainty that was being created by espousing the cause of
what do you say to the people who think that he was purchased?
I don't have anything to say to them.
More loyal than the king, some people say. That Farooq Abdullah with the Special Operations Group and the Special Task Force, which, at least according to a report I have from the Human Rights Watch, have been held responsible for human rights violations in the valley. Did he, when he did come to power, try to disband it?
No.
Why not?
Because the security environment didn't allow for it.
Does it now?
I wish it had been disbanded, but it hasn't. It was one of the planks of the current government of their Healing Touch policy, but events have shown that, that has turned out to be a hollow promise, and the SOG or the task force continues to function in Jammu and Kashmir.
As one of the most powerful chief ministers of the province, one would expect him to take some sort of action on human rights violations.
Oh, sure he did.
Especially by the SOG and the SDF.
Action against human rights violations was taken. You look at the actions after the actions after Pathribal, where a lot of heads rolled, a lot of other cases were registered against police officers that were found responsible for human rights violations. But whether we like it or not, the writ of the state government doesn't run to the army and the other security forces. They fall under the responsibility of the government of India, and no chief minister, be it Dr. Abdullah, Mufti Muhammad Sayyid or Ghulam Nabi Azad, can take any action against those forces.
I have a quote here from you, June 30, 2003, to Businessline in an article titled, India has weakened itself by going nuclear. You said the National Conference it says the National Conference president and MP, Mr. Omar Abdullah, says that by going nuclear and talking more than acting, quote unquote, India has weakened itself on Kashmir vis-a-vis Pakistan. We cannot go to war with Pakistan. India has weakened itself by going nuclear. Prior to that, we could defeat Pakistan in a conventional war. Sounds like you're itching for a war.
No, I've stated a fact, and it's true. The nuclear option has, whether for good or for bad, made sure that these two countries will never fight. And let's not forget, we've already had three wars, and not every one of them was India's choosing. I think you need to go back to your history books and look at the fact that every time India has fought a war, war has been waged on India. India has not waged war, and therefore it is not we who are itching for a war.
Some people argue otherwise.
Well, it depends on which side of the line you happen to find yourself. But no, I'm not, I would be the last one who'd be interested in a war, because whether I like it or not, the majority of that war will probably be fought in my part of the world, and I'd rather avoid that. But yes, by going nuclear, this is the way I saw things, and that was that.
You don't think nuclear deterrence is a good thing?
Sure, as long as it remains a deterrence, but I don't remember your country saying that they won't use theirs first. At least India has been responsible enough to say that we have a no first use policy, and it's only as a deterrence. But I recall your leadership saying, particularly when we were at eyeball to eyeball, that Pakistan does not have a no first use policy, and that if they choose to, they will be the first ones to use one against India.
Pakistan is a smaller country with a smaller army.
That doesn't justify using a nuclear bomb. I mean, how can you justify using a nuclear bomb just on the basis of size?
It times that of Pakistan's on the other side.
How does size justify the use of a nuclear bomb? I don't see the logic in that. The idea is, if you have to use it as a deterrence, then say it's a deterrence and we're not using it for offensive purposes. But to turn around and say that Pakistan's a smaller country and therefore we'll lob a nuclear bomb when we feel like it, that doesn't make much sense to me.
Do you think India has made Pakistan feel a little safer, perhaps, to convince it to sign up to a no-first-use policy?
I don't see why not. What has India done to damage your interests?
71, perhaps? Remember that?
71 was not the creation of India, come off it. As I said, it depends which side of the line you're looking on. And I don't know why we drag ourselves into the past instead of looking towards the future. Yes, we don't have the best of histories. Yes, we haven't been the most trusting neighbors. Sure, we haven't been the best of friends. But you can't pick up India and put it somewhere else, nor can we pick up Pakistan and relocate it anywhere else on the globe. We are destined to be neighbors so long as this world is in existence. And therefore, I think it's our moral duty to try and step away from the tensions of the past and the suspicions of the past and actually build a relationship of trust and friendship. And to the extent that we can do so by promising not to nuke each other, I see no reason why we shouldn't.
What have you personally helped create an environment for peace? Because I have a quote from you, another one. This is to the BBC in 4 October 2001. And you said, this is what you suggested, India's junior foreign minister, this is when you were the state minister for external affairs, Omar Abdullah told BBC's Question Time yesterday that India should send its forces into Pakistan to destroy terrorist training camps, quote unquote. It does not have to be done. overtly, he said. You can do it covertly and destroy these camps, because otherwise bleeding by a thousand cuts is really not the way to go about it. You are for covert strikes into Pakistani territory.
I was, and there's no denying that. I lived in a state that was being bled by these terrorist camps that I talked about. I had workers that died. You talk about human rights violations. Do my political workers not have rights? When these fellows came across from these camps and slit their throats in the night, dismembered their faces, chopped off their noses, chopped off their ears, cut out their tongues, only because they belonged to the National Conference, did my people not have rights? Did the Kashmiri Pandit population that was chased out of Jammu and Kashmir only because they didn't believe in the Allah that I believe in, did they not have human rights or rights? And therefore, sure, at that time, the relationship between our two countries was such that these were sentiments or expressions of what I believed in and what I felt, and I said it. I mean, you at that time had two countries that were about to go to war with each other. And sure, I was angry, and I think I had every reason to be.
Are you blaming the militancy completely on Pakistan?
No, I'm not. There was an indigenous movement, in as much as the youngsters were angry, and they needed somehow to channel this anger. But we don't grow guns in Jammu and Kashmir. We don't grow grenades in Jammu and Kashmir. We grow apples, we grow almonds, we grow flowers. But I have yet to see a tree that grows AK-47s or grows grenades or claymore mines. Those had to have come from somewhere.
But speaking of, let's talk about your role in this particular statement. You're a Kashmiri politician. You're supposed to be a creator of bridges, one would say, on either side. Because there's some people on the other side who also have affinities with you. But suggesting covert strikes into Pakistani territory.
Circumstances prevail at which you take a position or you do what you have to do in the best interest of your people and your land. General Pervez Musharraf today is seen as the driver of a peace process between India and Pakistan. But this is the same General Pervez Musharraf who planned and executed Kargil after Prime Minister Vajpayee's visit to on the bus where he was received by Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif at that time. But a man who could plan and implement Kargil and then becomes a peacemaker, travels to Agra with a peace message, suggests a four-point formula that doesn't include Security Council resolutions and the right to self-determination. Sure, we all say things at one point in time or the other, which then we either don't follow up on, or we say that, look, at that time this is what we felt, but times have changed and we would like to be seen as implementers or facilitators of a peace rather than a war. I think that is a right that we as individuals have to determine where we stand. I don't think there are very many people who all their lives have said one thing and stood completely by it, except maybe leaders like Mahatma Gandhi, and I'm certainly no Mahatma Gandhi.
All right, we have to take a short break here. We're talking to Umar Abdullah. You're watching Talk Back. Stay tuned.